What's up, everybody? Matt Moran here for another weekly update. So there is a ton of news to go over this week, and the first good chunk of it here is all Ford news. So if you don't like Ford news, use the timestamps in the description below there to skip ahead to the stuff you are interested in. But lots of interesting Ford stuff here. First, there was a dealer convention in Las Vegas this past week, and that's where a lot of these stories are coming from, where they showed over 3,000 dealers from the United States and Canada, several new models, including the Mustang-inspired electric performance crossover, the GT500, 2020 Escape and Explorer, and some others, supposedly. And they also launched their Built Ford Proud campaign, which I will talk about here in a minute. That ties into another story. This wasn't any kind of public reveal, so that's why there wasn't any photography allowed, and there's no pictures of any of these vehicles, except for one. Someone managed to sneak two quick shots of the GT500. I'm sure Ford is not happy about it, but it is out there in the public now, so I'm going to post it, repost it here. It was shared on Instagram thanks to Sinister Lifestyle, so they're the ones that shared that, and this is exactly what we were expecting. A lot of people were surprised to see the old headlights, which were already confirmed in the teaser that Ford showed back in Detroit in January, and I posted that teaser. You can watch it if you want to see. Clearly lines up with everything you're seeing in this picture. This picture is totally legit. It's confirmed by other dealers as being legit, and so this is what it is. I'm not super, super impressed. Honestly, I think the grille looks exactly like an Evo 10. And the old headlights, I mean, they work on the GT350, but I really just wish they would have given it the new headlights. I think, Ford might have been a little scared off by everyone hating the 2018 refresh originally, but I think now most people seem to still like it. At least the headlights, maybe not the front bumper, but the headlights most people seem to like. So it would have been nice to include that, because it just looks like it's already a three-year-old car, honestly, to me. And I mean, it looks like it's going to be very impressive. Lots of aero. Obviously, there's just two little grainy shots here, so we'll have much more, and I'm sure it'll look better in the official images, but I don't know. I'm personally not super wowed by it. I'm sure the performance will be there. You know, there is reports saying high 700 horsepower, like 780, 790, worth being thrown around, but that's nothing official or confirmed. But anyway, so cool to at least see the little glimpse of that. I'm hoping we see the full final reveal at the Detroit Auto Show in January. Maybe LA would be nice in November, but we'll have to wait and see. But moving on to the next bit of news here. This is where the reports from this event get a little more shaky. Because again, I think people signed non-disclosures, and so people weren't really supposed to be talking about this a whole lot anyway. But there's a poster on Mustang 6G named R. James 18 that claims to have two different sources that are supposedly saying that Ford talked about a four-door Mustang that would be a competitor to the Audi A7 and Porsche Panamera and would have a turbo V8 engine. There's lots of this that sound iffy. I mean, it's a strong possibility that the next-gen Mustang could go to a smaller V8 that's turbocharged. Downsizing V8s is how a lot of these companies are keeping V8s while making them more fuel efficient. And so that, isn't out of the range of possibilities, but a four-door one is a little more of an iffy thing. I mean, this is entirely possible, but just the way that they phrased this, they said it would look more like a crossover than an SUV, so maybe like the Sport Turismo version of the Panamera, like a wagon shooting brake type thing. But again, they're talking about this being like a crossover and a Mustang crossover. And that is what a lot of people are using to describe the electric one, which is a Mustang inspired crossover. So I don't think they would do that and then also have this. So this is where, like I said, things get a little confusing. So I think it's possible that Ford could possibly offer an electric version of this, electric, performance crossover, or whatever, and then possibly a gas version as well, maybe. Although it seems like the EV is going to be on its own unique platform and be a completely different thing. So I'm not really sure what to make of that report. We'll have to wait and see, what ends up turning up. But to further confuse things, the new Built Ford Proud commercial, they debuted it there as well, but that's, you can watch it on YouTube. It has Bryan Cranston in it and stuff. And it's a cool commercial, except it's a little confusing because it shows a glowing Mustang pony on the front of some future vehicle that we don't recognize as anything offered currently. And right before that image, we do see the image of a V8, but it looks like a cross-section of the current V8 engine. So I don't think this is anything meaning it's going to be a hybrid V8. I think it's just like showing like an evolution. Like we're going from this big V8 engine to a glowing Mustang pony, which means probably some type of electric, and then going into the future, since we know that's what them and the rest of the car world is obsessed with. So I think that's kind of what that was suggesting. I don't think this is showing any kind of engine for a hybrid or something like that. I think it's just showing, hey, the Mustang's going futuristic. But this image is also very confusing of what it is we're looking at here with this Mustang emblem on it. So first off, the grille is closed, which means that it's, I mean, there are some vehicles that have gas engines that have closed off grills, but they have grills elsewhere to get cooling up to the engine. And so, I mean, this, I really think this is an EV. I think that's what it's either hinting at a future EV Mustang, or this is a first glimpse of that crossover that's Mustang based, or, you know, Mustang inspired. Now, if this is, you know, if they are just trying to go with a futuristic design thing, and there is some kind of lower air dam that has lots of cooling to, you know, run up to the engine there, then this could be an actual legitimate look at the next gen Mustang, which isn't due till 2020 calendar year, 2021 model year. So still would be a little early to see something like that. I mean, it is a very short little teaser image, but I think they're planning on doing that EV crossover before the next gen Mustang. So I think that's why I'm kind of leaning towards this being the crossover. Other things that make me lean towards this being the crossover here is it looks like it's a taller front end than what you see on a Mustang or any other coupe for that matter, where you see that grille, you see the headlights, everything's very big and blocky, and then there's this whole other shaded portion down below it that seems like it's a very tall profile, almost like a Ford Edge or something like that in its type of profile there. So that kind of makes me think it's an SUV. Also, the windshield looks a little more vertical than what you would see on a very, you know, swoopy Mustang concept, or even just the current Mustang, I think, has a lower windshield than what you see there. So that also is kind of suggesting to me, at least, that this is the electric crossover, except there's one snafu. It has a Mustang badge on it. Even the Ford site says that the Mustang-inspired crossover is that. Mustang-inspired. Not a Mustang, but inspired. I really hope Ford doesn't try and pull an Eclipse Cross and just call this like the Mustang Cross or something like that, and, you know, try and attach the actual Mustang name and badge to this electric crossover. I think that is where you start to get to the pitchfork area of the Ford fanboy section, where people get really, really upset. You know, there people are already mad about just the Mach 1 name on its own, let alone if you call it Mustang something. I don't know how well that would go over. So I think, again, I still am going, I'm rooting for Thunderbolt or Lightning as names for this crossover, something cool like that that's different. You know, I know they already teased that it's going to have Mustang tail lamps, but hopefully they kind of limit themselves on how much of the Mustang branding they use on this thing. But anyway, yeah, we'll have to wait and see. If this is actually just the next-gen Mustang they're teasing, then it's definitely interesting as far as Mustang styling goes, because it has, you know, the dual, I guess, beam headlamps there, which almost actually makes it look like the Fox bodies from the early 80s, and the, you know, very 80s-inspired there. And actually, the headlights look a lot like a Subaru concept to me, honestly. If it wasn't for the Mustang badge, you could put a Subaru badge on the front of that, and I would buy that as, like, the new Legacy or something all day long. So that's just my take on it, but anyway, very interesting, you know, to get all that info there from the meeting at the dealer conference. And we got a little more info on the Bronco here recently, too. So that was confirmed to be coming in 2020. And Road and Track got confirmation previously that the Ranger, according to the president of Ford America, the Bronco will be based on the Ranger platform. So that means it'll actually be a body-on-frame, truck-based SUV, which is wonderful news. Instead of it, you know, being melded into some crossover blob thing, I'm really glad they're keeping the Bronco as a tough truck-based SUV. I think that'll be great. But the new news here this week is that we know Ranger production is starting this week, and they also announced that that's the same plant where the Bronco will be built. They're going to be built alongside the Ranger there in Michigan, which is awesome to hear, and so cool to, you know, get that bit of news. Speaking of the Ranger, though, we have some not so great news about the Ranger. This comes from vehicle line director for Ford Performance, who confirmed to journalists this week that Ford doesn't have plans to sell that new Ranger Raptor in the United States at all. He said it was developed for regions that didn't get the F-150 Raptor, and so it was designed so that all regions could have some form of a Raptor, and that's why they were doing this. And, you know, they cited a few other reasons. You know, the F-150 Raptor is a really strong seller, and so there's not very much demand for anything else, which I don't think is true. I think there would be a lot of people that would love a Ranger Raptor. Also, you know, in the markets where it is sold, it has a diesel engine, which, you know, isn't super, you know, well received these days. And, you know, is another weak excuse, though, to me, because I think, you know, right now the Ranger here in the States will run a 2.3 liter EcoBoost, and that motor in the Mustang is faster and the Focus RS has more power. Very easy to, you know, just use those same power adders for the Ranger version and call it a Ranger Raptor. I mean, even the Colorado ZR2 doesn't have any extra horsepower. It's just the off-road stuff. So they don't even have to boost horsepower to still be competitive with the Colorado ZR2 and just give it that off-road stuff. Because otherwise, people are just going to do it in the aftermarket. If Ford doesn't sell it to them, people will just go do it on their own. So I really feel like Ford's missing out on additional revenue there by not offering it. And I know, you know, they might not want to cannibalize F-150 sales. I think that might be part of it as well. As you know, the F-150 is the sales leader, and the Ranger, or you know, the Raptor version of the F-150 contributes to that. So if you start cannibalizing sales, people are like, oh, well, I can save $5,000 to $8,000 and go for the Ranger Raptor instead. Maybe they would. That would hurt F-150 sales, might not make it the number one selling truck, although I think it's leading by a wide margin. But even still, I think Ford wants to protect its cash cow, and that's understandable, but a little bit of a bummer there. You know, we get more forbidden fruit that we can't have here. So anyway, interesting to hear that, and unfortunate for those Ranger Raptor fans. The last Ford news here is an announcement that Ford is extending GT supercar production an additional 2 years and an additional 350 units. So they originally were planning on making 1,000 of them, and they'd be done building them in 2020. Now they're going to produce until 2022, and there'll be 1,350 of them. So if you're interested in one of those ones, you're going to be able to, the application process starts again on November 8th, and we'll close 30 days after that. And I think it's the same criteria as before, you to have like social media following and, you know, show all these plans for driving the car lots and not just mothballing it and, you know, wanting it to be a collector vehicle. And speaking of those collectors, I'm sure they're upset that now the, you know, limited to 1,000 unit GT is now 1,350 units. But again, this is kind of showing, I think, I kind of like how Ford didn't want collectors to try and, you know, flip these cars and stuff. So I like that this kind of lowers the value of the GT in a way, but, you know, it just allows it to be opened up to people that actually want them so they can actually drive them and enjoy them. So I think this is a brilliant move, honestly, by Ford. So really great to see that. And we have some new spy photos of the Supra for the millionth time this year. And so this time, though, we do get a few actual new tidbits of info, and a few of the blanks have been filled in thanks to these new pictures. And I got these from my spy photographer, Brian Williams, here. And so there's nothing new on the outside. It was these pictures were taken during some pit stops while racing on the Nürburgring. It was actually competing in a, you know, I guess prototype class or whatever. Anyway, although it's prepped for racing, it appears to have a mostly complete production interior, which, you know, kind of gives us a little more idea of what to expect for the production version, since that's all been covered up until now. So this shows that the interior won't be the same as the Z4, actually, which is a nice surprise, but still almost exclusively uses BMW parts bin parts. So, I mean, every piece of switchgear is straight out of a BMW. So it's a little disappointing. Even, like, the iDrive controller is from the current gen, not the new one. We do get a glimpse of the gauges there, which you can kind of partially see. Unfortunately, my spy photographer didn't get a good clear picture of that, but there was one posted on an autoblog, and I'll link that in the description if you want to see just a clearer view of that tack. And it looks really cool. Very large right in the middle there, and there's some bar-style gauges for fuel and others on the left and the right. And so that's really a cool and exciting-looking, you know, very race car-like gauge cluster, which is great. Some other stuff here is that the spy photographer was able to get some shots under the hood there, but it, you know, just there's a mess of hoses and wires and doesn't look very attractive, honestly, which is why a lot of companies use these engine covers these days, because there's just way too much complicated stuff under there now. It's not like the simple engines of the past. One interesting thing, though, according to my spy photographer in his report here, he's saying that he's heard that BMW is keeping the highest performing version of that six-cylinder turbo engine for themselves for the, you know, top version of the Z4, which means that the Supra won't be getting that 381 horsepower version. Instead, the Supra's most powerful version of 340 horsepower. According to this report, nothing confirmed, but that's what they're hearing. If that's the case, it almost sounds like there's some bad blood between BMW and Toyota after this whole thing. So we'll have to see, yeah, how that pans out. There's also, according to this report, going to be a 265 horsepower turbo four-cylinder version version as well. We knew there's gonna be a four cylinder that was confirmed by the engineer, but 265 horsepower being the number is interesting. And so that kind of makes it the perfect vehicle for those that always wanted a turbo BRZ or 86 from the factory. Here you go, you get 65 extra horsepower, basically very similar dimensions to a BRZ and FRS, and you know, you have the additional reliability of a warranty and stuff instead of just turboing a BRZ. Interesting to see those little pieces of the new Supra at least. Nissan has shown a single image of the front end of the refreshed 2019 Maxima this week. Just one image. We'll have more closer to the reveal at the LA Auto Show at the end of next month. But from this one image, I mean, it looks really good. Actually, and it's just a refreshed version of the current car, though, so it's not an all-new Maxima or anything. There's likely going to be some changes to the back end as well, and of course some changes to the interior, little updates here and there. But Nissan has said these are actually going to be in dealers by December, so very quick rollout. And again, since it's just a light refresh, that's pretty easy to do. But anyway, we'll be seeing those on the streets soon. Genesis has revealed a new digital gauge cluster for the G70 for the Korean market version. It's a 12.3-inch screen with a different appearance themes, including modern, comfort, smart, space, eco, edge, and sport. And it looks cool, but Genesis has told AutoGuide that it is yet to be determined if it'll be offered in the U.S. It probably wouldn't come until the 2020 model year if it did. I think this is just, they needed to, I guess, introduce it to compete with BMW and stuff in Korea, but I think they don't want to tell people, like, yeah, this is coming next year, don't buy a 2019, because they need people to buy 2019s. So I think they're kind of in a tricky position as far as timing and stuff goes on that. But anyway, a very cool looking gauge cluster there from the one picture we have, and hopefully we do get it. Audi has shown a teaser for the new R8. Actually, while I was editing this video, Audi fully revealed the refreshed R8 with all these great pictures. And I'm actually really impressed with it. The changes make it look really a lot more aggressive to me than the previous version of the R8. And strangely though, they haven't shown any pictures of the back end aside from the lower bumper. So I'm not sure what the taillights look like. Hopefully we'll see those soon. It also has two new wheel designs, but only one is pictured there. But that one that we do see does look a lot more aggressive, and I just really love the way that looks now. Anyway, these are going to be arriving first in Europe early next year, both in coupe and spider body styles, and we'll continue to use the V10 with two different tunes for the regular and plus versions, but they didn't give any horsepower numbers for what those new tunes will bring. I'm assuming there'll be a small horsepower bump, but still probably beneath the Huracan Performante and stuff like that. Other things though, there's no sign of those rumored smaller engines that we were hearing about, possibly being thrown in there. So maybe that'll come later on or never, who knows. Some other changes here though that are confirmed are an improved dry sump oil system to work above 1.5 lateral G, because they're really trying to make it a better handling vehicle, along with suspension and all-wheel drive system updates with additional sensors for better performance. There are new steering modes that have better response and feedback supposedly, and a retuned ESC system to improve braking performance as well, so it actually stops a little quicker. They've also tried to make it lighter, with one example that Audi gave being the front sway bar is now aluminum and carbon fiber for a 4.4 pound weight savings. And otherwise the interior seems mostly unchanged, but overall this seems like a really awesome update for the R8, and like I said, I'm really loving that new front end. I think it looks great. So anyway, cool to see that. Last week, I talked about the Camaro shock concept that's going to be shown at SEMA here next week, and how I'm willing to bet they'll be quickly making this change to all Camaros. And I said last week how I think it improves the looks, and I think Chevy was kind of scrambling whenever everyone hated the 2019 Camaro refresh. And it turns out that my hunch might be correct. According to GM Authority, they just issued a report saying that that front bumper change is being fast-tracked to production. And so how fast remains to be seen. Apparently, 2019 Camaros are already starting to hit dealerships, and they're sitting. People aren't interested in them. They don't like the styling, and that's showing because they're sitting at dealers, and I think dealers are complaining about it. So I think, I don't know if this is going to be a mid-model year change, if they can do it that fast, or if this will have to wait till the 2020 model year to have this change put into place. But Anyway, seems to be hurting Camaro sales that already were hurting, being in last place in the Mustang, or in the muscle car sales race. You know, the Mustang being first, Challenger being second, and Camaro last. And so yeah, it's Camaro's like far and away like much less than even the Challenger. So not good times there for Chevy as far as the Camaro marketing team. So hopefully they can improve that and turn their sales luck around a little bit. Some other GM news. There are a few interesting pictures that showed up on the Cadillac XT4 Micro site this past week. And the first image here shows a possible V version of the XT4. And while it's just a sketch, so it might be a little more dramatic, it looks to have a very wide appearance. It's got some really wide tires, especially. And so that suggests it could actually be a high-performance version and not just some appearance package. An appearance package wouldn't have super wide tires like that. So, you know, I don't know. Again, this is just a sketch on a piece of paper. Who knows? But it would be cool if it had, like, the ATS-V motor in it. Of course, we can dream and hope for the CTS-V motor or even the CT6, you know, V-Sport, that new twin turbo V8. Any of those would be great, you know, just a faster version. But if it had the ATS-V motor, that could compete with like the GLC43, the SQ5, and the X3 M40i and stuff. And so, you know, we'll just have to wait and see. The other image here is a clay model in the background showing a curvy coupe. And hopefully that's something, again, we're going to see as a concept at some point down the road, or maybe even as a production model would be wonderful. We'll have to wait and see, but looks very attractive from just the silhouette we can see there. And a future GM vehicle that was actually spied out in the open was this new three-row crossover that the spy photographer believes is a Buick, although there hasn't been a name given for this Buick that we've heard yet. But it's supposedly going to be positioned in between the Envision and the Enclave, and will most likely be similar in size to the GMC Acadia. And it's probably going to share, it's going to be on the Chi platform, and so it means it might actually share some components with the Cadillac XT6, which is also under development currently and is also on that same platform. But we'll have to wait and see if they share anything. But it's hard to tell, you know, too much about the styling based on these spy photos since it's just so well covered up. But anyway, interesting to see them working on that. One vehicle that we do probably know the name for now is Aston Martin's new Project 003, which is a vehicle, it's a mid-engine hypercar coming after the Valkyrie, and is most likely using some type of like a turbo V6, I think, with a hybrid thing going on with it, and will be, you know, kind of supposed to compete with the McLaren Speedtail that's coming and a few others. Anyway, AutoGuide has found a trademark application for the name Valhalla, and it's I guess goes back to the Norse legends and mythology stuff, which is what the Valkyrie and other names are based on, and another V name fits right in with all the others. And so yeah, we'll have to see, you know, if they end up using that one or not. But anyway, cool to hear that. McLaren, speaking of hypercars, has confirmed to Piston Heads that a new bespoke customer commission is being created by McLaren Special Operations called the BC-03. And it's essentially going to be a production version of the Ultimate Vision Gran Turismo concept that was shown last year. But that car had like a crazy motorcycle-like driving position that will almost certainly, you know, not make it into this production vehicle. But the McLaren Life Forum did give a little more info on this vehicle, claiming that only 5 will be made, 3 have already been claimed, and that they'll be $3 million each. And they're supposedly going to be inspired by that concept car, but will use new cutting-edge technologies and a special type of carbon fiber. And the concept, though, did end up using the 4-liter twin-turbo V8, you know, from the 720S, combined with 2 electric motors on the front axle, so that it had all-wheel drive, 1,134 horsepower and 940 pound-feet of torque. So we'll have to see what they end up using on the production version, or how much of it can actually share with, you know, this video game car, since it's kind of hard to put some of that stuff into production. So we'll have to see, but anyway, must be fun to have tons of money. Next year, Porsche has confirmed that a production version of the Mission E Cross Turismo is going to be coming. They did confirm that, although obviously now it's not called the Mission E, it's the Taycan. So this will most likely be called either like the Taycan Cross Turismo or Sport Turismo. It just depends on whether or not Porsche is actually going to give it that crossover styling with the plastic body cladding, or whether they're going to just do like a wagon version like the Panamera Sport Turismo, which I think is the more likely one. I think there were some spy pictures taken that I didn't have access to, but were taken last week, showing a wagon version of the Taycan being tested and didn't seem to be lifted or anything. So I think they're probably just, I mean, they could do a crossover thing though. We'll have to see, but there's some other more versatile version of the Taycan coming is the consensus here, which is cool to hear. Some other Porsche news here is that AutoGuide is reporting that a Cayman T might be coming next year, and most likely is, because it was listed in a VIN document Porsche submitted to the NHTSA that included new 2019 model year vehicles, such as the 911 Speedster, and the GTS versions of the Panamera were included in this list as well. And so Auto Express has a different report about a Cayman T, and I think theirs might not be correct, but I'm going to show, you know, just report both of them here. Auto Express, they claim that it's going to lose 44 pounds for this Cayman T with the same changes made to the Carrera T, which means you have the lightweight glass rear window, the cloth door pulls, and a bunch of other lightweighting stuff to kind of simplify. They'd strip the radio out of the vehicle and all that type of stuff. And so that's what they're saying the version of the T will have. It also, so according to them, will have 10 more horsepower from the 2.5-liter flat four for 360 horsepower total, which would kind of be stepping on the toes of the GTS a little bit. It'd be kind of like an in-between thing. That's what they're saying in Auto Express, is this like a midway point between the S and the GTS. But I don't think you need a midway point there, since there's not a whole lot of price difference between the two. So AutoGuide's report differs and makes more sense to me, where they're saying that the VIN documents list the T as getting the base Cayman's 2-liter flat four with horsepower listed as to be determined. But this sounds more likely, considering the Carrera T was based on the slowest Carrera with a base engine, and so I think, you know, it was giving that base Carrera a performance version of its own, and I think that would make sense for the base Cayman. For those who don't want the faster one for whatever reason, you can now have this, you know, better handling, sportier version of the base Cayman if you want, without jumping up to the Cayman S. And so that's, I think, makes a little more sense there to me, and that's what AutoGuide's reporting, so I think that's what I would bet on. And the last few stories this week are actually all about Tesla. Just quick little stories here. First is they released software 9.0, the update, which includes Tesla Tari, they call it, which is using the steering wheel controls to play Asteroid, Centipede, Lunar Lander, and Missile Command while parked. And Elon Musk had mentioned also Pole Position, where he actually used the steering wheel to steer in the game, but that hasn't been included so far, so I'm guessing there might be a little more complicated to disconnect the steering wheel from actually steering the wheels to steering on the video game. Might be get a little tricky, so that one's not included, but the other ones are there. Other Tesla news here is they've removed the full self-driving option from the configurator for all Tesla models. That was something they've been selling, I think, since 2016. They advertise it as, you know, kind of future-proofing yourself, so whenever full self-driving Teslas are available in just a few years, you'll be able to have it all ready to go in your Tesla, which is a little bit of a false promise. But the reason, supposedly, that Elon's claiming for why they pulled the configurator option is that it caused too much confusion, was his reasoning. Yeah, it's confusing because people are like, oh, people that don't know any better are like, wow, I can get to be full self-driving in a year or two. And it's like, no, full self-driving vehicles like this are still far further away than people realize. This isn't something coming in the next few years. This is coming in like the next 10 years, if we're lucky, or unlucky, depending on what your view of the systems are. But anyway, so yeah, and I mean, it's just a little bit of a false thing. Now, supposedly Tesla, they're not offering any refunds because they are still actively working towards making this available, and those that got the option will have this enabled at some point. But it was $5,000, and I don't understand, like, that's a lot of money to be plopping down for something that, you know, I guess those who really believe that Tesla could do it that soon. But I mean, even just regulatory approval just is holding this stuff up. So even if they have the tech to do it and the advanced, you know, stuff, it's, which they don't, it would still take far longer than anyone realizes. So it was kind of dumb to even get the option to begin with. But those who did, sounds like you're not getting a refund. So sorry about that. Anyway, The last story this week is also a Tesla one, and it's Tesla has officially made a new trim for the Model 3 available this week, and it's a $45,000 version that has rear-wheel drive and a mid-range battery, which seems to have the same battery pack as a long-range car, but is limited to 50 miles less for a total of 260 miles of range. It also has a slower 0 to 60 of 5.6 seconds, since it only has the one motor instead of the dual motor, which is all that was currently available, is the dual motor ones. So now this is the first of the single motor. So less performance, 5.6 seconds instead of the 4.5 seconds of the dual motor ones for 0 to 60. It also has a lower top speed of 125 miles per hour instead of 145. And but we're still waiting on the true, you know, base model version, which is supposed to be, you know, $35,000 and widely available and stuff. And those aren't coming now until sometime next year. So we'll have to see when next year. It doesn't seem to be coming anytime super soon. But anyway, at least now you can get one a little more affordable, and they are claiming, you know, if you still take delivery of one of these by the end of the year, you can still get the full $7,500 tax credit. And after the, I think January 1st is when that gets cut in half. So I think this is them trying to be like, we're not ready to do the $35,000 version, but we'll do $45,000 and you get $7,500 off still, and kind of make up the difference a little bit. So anyway, but cool to see that they're starting to get a little more affordable for those out there that, you know, are waiting for the cheaper ones. And anyway, interesting to hear all that. But yes, that's it for all the news this week, guys. Let me know your thoughts and everything in the comments below. Thank you guys very much for watching. I'll see you next week. Take care.